Good morning.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Di.
I'm Andrew.
And we are
the Moreland City Salvos
Ministers. It's so hard to describe what we are, but that's what we are. We are the ministers here at Moreland City
Salvos.
We are lots of things. If you're joining us for the first time, we just encourage you to head over to our YouTube channel and press subscribe and you'll catch everything. And click the little bell, you'll get all the notifications for everything that happens, as well as Facebook.
Yes.
Lots of things happen on our Facebook page. You'll see live updates all the time. You'll see lots of activities happening, lots of posts on everything that's going on. You'll join us on Mondays with our Mad Major Mondays, where lots of bad things happen.
A little bit crazy.
And also on Thursdays with our Connect In, and then again on Sundays. And also TTT, which is fantastic, our young people with the trivia. Yeah, we've had some interesting moments there. But today we're continuing our series with
Evangelism.
Our back to basic series, Evangelism. So I think Camp Mother,
it's over to Camp Leader
are going to take us away.
There you go, Camp Mother.
I'm going okay. I'm reluctant to move too far.
Don't move too much because you've got a wombat right near your shoulder.
I got a wombat on my shoulder.
And a koala too.
And a koala. It seems that the Lord is adding to our number daily.
Oh, that sounds even scriptural.
I know.
Wow.
We got wombats, we got koalas.
Emus,
kangaroos.
And I think there's even a wombat in our tent.
I do not know where we're sleeping tonight, because I ain't going in the tent with a wombat. I can tell you right
goodness
now.
Goodness me.
No way, Camp Leader. I am not going in there.
That is ridiculous.
I tell you though, Major Di, she has a word today.
Yes.
About evangelism.
Evangelism.
Now, let me tell you a little secret. I think it's hilarious that Major Di is talking about evangelism, because you know how she feels about evangelism.
I do know how she feels about evangelism, Camp Mother.
Yeah, she's not a fan of it.
Not keen on it.
Not keen on it.
No.
So it'll be very interesting to see what she has to say about evangelism.
Yeah.
And how the Lord adds to the number daily.
We're not talking fairy friends either.
No. Although.
But in this case it is.
We have been known to have a few fairy friends at the Moreland City. We do. Shout out to Frankie, she often comes.
Frankie, your buddy.
I know who you were thinking about. Camp Leader. I was thinking about Frankie.
Oh, Frankie, okay.
Yeah. Jesus, creepers. You never know where his sneakers are. Anyway, today Major Di is going to talk about evangelism, and I think she's going to talk about it in a different light.
Well, good.
It's going to be different.
Good.
Different than anyone ever thought.
We do things a little bit differently.
A little bit weird.
A little bit strange.
That's how we go.
Thanks, Kate.
That's us. Well, wow. I feel like we might need to feed the troops.
Yeah, they're looking pretty hungry.
Yeah, I think
they're looking pretty stuffed, if you ask me.
Looking at my damper down there.
They look pretty stuffed to me.
Oh, my word. Even out in the bush, the jokes continue here.
Oh.
They just keep rolling off your tongue like pearls of
wisdom.
Yeah, okay.
Yep.
We'll go with that.
All right.
Yep, thanks. Well, let's enjoy Major Di talking about out of Acts 2, and they added to the number daily.
Yes.
I wonder if there's any wombats or
emus
or koalas.
Wombat. Maybe it might be something.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. Who knows?
Stay tuned.
Over to you, Major Di. Well, good morning, church. We're back again. Camp Leader and Camp Mother never cease to amaze us, do they? With their sense of humour and mischief, it's one for a better word than those two right now. But to continue in the theme of that, I can tell you right now, I do believe God has a sense of humor. He absolutely has a sense of humor. Why do I say that? He has a sense of humor because when we were planning out this series and we were looking at what we believed were the foundations of the church, and you know we've already done love and prayer, this week in my mind, Andrew would be speaking to you. In my mind, it was all worked out, absolutely no doubt. Because the topic that we're going to talk about today is evangelism. And, well, when I hear that word, already as I say it, I can feel my heart racing faster and faster, and not with excitement. I can tell you now, not with excitement. That word evangelism brings me no excitement whatsoever. It absolutely freaks me out. Andrew loves it, all over it. Me, not so much. But we have to understand that when we're looking at the foundations of a church, we believe that evangelism is a key part of what a faith community is. Like, a faith community has to have a purpose. It has to have a divine purpose if you're a spiritual community. It has to have a divine purpose. Otherwise, it's just a social club. Like, otherwise we've just got something in common that we all gather to and do. Well, that's actually not what we're called to be a faith community. We should have a divine purpose. And our divine purpose is to share the mission, is to engage in the mission, is to be disciples, is to see people come to Jesus, is to see the kingdom of God grow and expand and bring joy. But when I think of the word evangelism, I get a bit nervous, I've got to say. I think it's a bit of an overused word, and it conjures up thoughts of street preachers and televangelists. Maybe that's what I am now, oh my goodness. But all these other images come into mind that kind of sway from what I really think evangelism is. I'm gonna let you in on a little bit of a secret about me, and it will come as a surprise for some people who don't know me very well yet. But you know I love people, right? I just love being with people, but I don't like meeting them. I can all hear you say, what? Like, I don't like meeting people. I walk into a room, when I've got to meet someone for the first time, I walk into the room and it's like, you know what, on the movies where the room sort of sways and it's like, oh, it's terrifying, overwhelming. I walk into a room of all new people. When I go to a conference, every time I start a new appointment, sorry, Morelanders, but it was the same. Every time I start a new appointment and I've got to meet all these new people, my heart is racing, my palms are sweaty, and you know how cold I am, so that tells you something. And I just feel all clammy and I'm nervous and overwhelmed. Andrew walks into a new room, he's like, it's Christmas, let's go, this is exciting, who are we gonna meet? And it's bing, 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 and he's off and away and he just loves it. He loves meeting new people and just, it really fires him up and it's great. But me, oh no, it causes me a lot of stress. In fact, I can remember when we were in college, and John Farquharson, and I hope he's watching because then he can see how deeply scarred I am from this activity. But he challenged us one day. He was sitting in class and he says to us, here's $5, get on a tram and get rid of this $5. Just take someone out for coffee, just give them food, do something, go and meet new people, get on the tram, head into Melbourne, get rid of $5. I remember turning to Andrew and going, what did he just ask? For me to get on a tram and talk to a total stranger, and by the way, like, I just, my eyes were like saucers. Now I turned to Andrew, I'm like, and he's like, oh, when's the next tram? I'm there, give me the $5, I'm out of here. I'm not joking, before he even got into the city, he was talking to someone and taking him out for a coffee. He is crazy. He just loves meeting new people. He loves talking about Jesus, and the whole thought of this for him is just amazing, and he loves it. For me though, this word evangelism and the thought to do evangelism that way just really raises my pulse. But I'm really starting to see, as I get into the word and I go deeper into scriptures, that there's actually different ways to do evangelism. There's different ways in which we're called to reach people for the gospel. And so I want to sort of share a bit about what I've been growing within me and as I read the word. It has to do really with the passage that we're reading in Acts. I mean, I know for the Salvation Army, it's been very much about sending out, and often when we talk about evangelism, it's like we must go, we've got to go somewhere other than where we are, we've got to go, we've got to reach, we've got to go. And I know, like, for commissioning, we get sent out, it's us, we get sent, and that's fine, that's the way Paul kind of worked. He was sent, he was a roaming evangelist, and he was sent, and so there's value in that. But there are other ways, and when I think about the Acts 2 church and I think about what happened, I'm drawn to a new and a different way. It says in Acts 2 that the believers were meeting together in one place. And when this is written and that's words are being spoken, it's at the time of Pentecost, which coincidentally we celebrate today as the Christian church is Pentecost today. But the festival of Pentecost was happening in Jerusalem at this time. And so there were people from all over who'd come and gathered into this city to give thanks. And it's a festival of give thanks for the harvest, for the crops and things. But somehow, in and amongst this festival, the new Jewish Christians found each other. They just gathered and they came together. And it's there that the Holy Spirit descended like a roaring wind through that place. And it's there where they started to speak in other languages and people started to hear the gospel for the very first time and understand it. It wasn't a foreign language anymore. They actually understood it. And it's here where God chose to really release evangelism into our world, to really make us think about how we would take the gospel into the world. It's so pivotal, the event at Pentecost. We continue to celebrate it even today. So what is it that happened there that makes it so pivotal to our Christian faith? Well, it tells me that gathering is still important to God. Okay, so for now we're gathering online and we're gathering in different formats, but we're still gathering. But gathering is really important to God. He wants us to come together as believers. He wants us to gather in this way. But it also says to me that Pentecost didn't just kind of happen off to the side, because if it did, we would never have heard about it. It just would have been one of those events that kind of just happened and we don't hear about it. But it was written in the scripture. It's written in the word. It's been passed down verbally for generation upon generation. We continue to celebrate it today. So something happened where suddenly this group of people who gathered acted differently. Something different happened, and it was so recognizable that it's been recorded. In fact, to be honest, if you read the word, it says that people thought they were drunk. They just had too much to drink. They got into the festivities and got a little bit carried away, and they're like, whoop, those guys have just lost the plot over there. I think there's, to me, something human about that response. I think sometimes as human, when we don't understand something, we often dismiss it or we explain it away. And I feel that in the passage, that's kind of what they're trying to do. It's such a human response. But we know there was a Holy Spirit movement that happened that day. We know that something magical and wonderful happened that day. And it happened because the church gathered. And then we see that Peter, he just brings this wonderful word. He just shares the gospel in a way that is so amazing. I hope I even can do it justice today, but he just does this wonderful sermon. And then we keep going down to the passage of scripture that we've been focusing on in this Back to Basics. You'll know that every week we come back to this passage because this is the passage that the Lord has given us to look at. And it's Acts 2, 43 to 47. And it says, I'm going to read from the Message translation because we've been doing different translations as we go, but I want to read from the Message translation today. And there's this line where it says, everyone was in awe, and all those wonders and signs done through the apostles, and all the believers lived in wonderful harmony. I mean, isn't that just a wonderful thought? But if you keep going down, it says, meals at home, every meal, and a celebration, exuberant joy. They praise God. And people in general liked what they saw. And every day their number grew as God added to those who were being saved. And this is interesting to me because this is a game changer for me when we look at evangelism, is that people gathered, they stayed, and the Lord added to their number daily. And it just made me think, does sometimes God require us to stay? To stay. I love the language from the Message translation where it says, and the people generally liked what they saw. They liked what this community did. They liked what they were doing in the impact in the community. They liked the change. They liked what was happening and they were attracted to it some way. And every day God grew their number of people who were saved. And it's just really interesting to me because we're in a season where we're being told, stay at home, don't go out. We're saying stay indoors. We're saying stay away from people who could be vulnerable. And so here we have in the Word of God where the Acts church gathered, stayed, and connected with their community. And I just wonder if the best thing we could do is to stay. But what does that really mean? I mean, the church didn't just stay. There was a big difference. Something happened. What happened is they started speaking in another language. Like, they started speaking in the languages, so when Jerusalem, people were coming from everywhere, there were different cultures and different things happening in that space, and suddenly, here we are, the Word of God, they understood. Do you know, one of my dear friends, she's been sent to an area, she's an English-speaking person who's been sent to a non-English-speaking community. I am so proud of her, just the way she handles the whole thing. But she figured out pretty quickly that she needs to learn the language because there's a massive communication barrier. How can she help these people or minister to these people when she can't even communicate with them? So she has put time aside and listens on her phone and always listening to stuff and finding apps to help her speak this other language just so she can connect. And I've witnessed her speak in broken other English. I don't want to say because I don't want to give away who she is, but in a broken language to communicate with these people because she just loves them so much and she wants to be able to communicate with them. And so here she is, she's decided to discipline herself to learn this new language. I mean, it's amazing. But in the Acts church, the Lord just blessed them with it. Wouldn't it be amazing if that could happen, that Lord could bless us this? But sometimes we have to work at it. Sometimes we have to work at a new language and figure it out. And it made me think, how much are we learning to speak the language of our community so we can connect? I mean, are we taking the time to learn about the community God has placed us in and where He has put us, so that we can speak their language? But how? Like, I can hear you saying, how? How can we do that, Di? You know, people speak English where we are, that's all right. Well, do you know, I was so drawn to the Romans passage, and as soon as I read it, everyone's gonna go, of course. But it's Romans 12, 1, 2, and 2, I wanna point out, and this is again the Message translation because I love the everyday language of it. And here it is. It said, so hear what I want you to do. God helping you, that's very important. God helping you take your everyday, ordinary life. Your sleeping, eating, going to work, walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Now think about that for a minute. We kind of take for granted that we go to sleep and we eat and go to work and walk around. But here in this passage, God is saying all those little insignificant things that you think are insignificant, I can use them. I can use them. So that doesn't seem too hard, does it? It doesn't really seem difficult at all. But if you keep going and you go down to verse 6, it talks about the gifts God gives us. In 6 it says, in His grace, God has given different gifts for doing certain things well. And for some, it's prophecy, and for some it's serving, and for some it's teaching, and for some it's encouraging, and for some it's generosity, and for some it's leadership. But here it is, you've all been given a gift. So here it seems that God says, we've got everything we need. Everything. We've got everything we need to learn how to speak the language of our community. Does that mean that we don't do certain things because it's not our gifting? No, it doesn't. I'm going to say that straight up. It's very clear to me that my husband has the gift of evangelism. He doesn't like it when I say that, but he really is very gifted at sharing Jesus with people in the most random places at any time. You could tap him on the shoulder and he'll just talk to you nonstop about Jesus. He just loves Jesus so much and he just shares that wherever he is, which is a wonderful, wonderful gift. I've been given what I often call is the sideways gift of encouragement. And there's a few people who know me and know that I grumbled about that for a very long time. I don't really understand what the gift of encouragement is. I think it's a made-up gift, but I'm hoping that I'm bringing you encouragement today. And so we know we work well together in that way. But it doesn't mean that God doesn't push me to do certain things. I mean, think about it for a moment. Can you imagine if I never pushed through meeting people? I mean, that would be silly, wouldn't it? You have to meet people. You have to have that first initial contact. It would be crazy. And we can't use the excuse, oh, that's not my gifting, so I'm not going to do it. Because I've heard that so many times. Because if the Holy Spirit asks you to do it and you don't do it, that's just disobedience, whether you're gifted or not. Because I could tell you that if I had not stepped out of all my giftings and taken the leap of faith, I would still be in Perth and I would have missed all the opportunities and experiences that God has given me over these 16 years of crazy officership. And I mean, I wouldn't even be speaking to you today in this way. I mean, it's unbelievable to me that this is my life. That's the truth. It's unbelievable to me that this is my life. But it is because God pushes me to step out of my comfort zone and grow me. However, there are some things that I find quite easy. There are some things that I feel natural about. And that's actually really where God wants me to work most of the time, unless he wants to grow me in some way. But isn't this music to our ears, to all those people who are not so keen about this whole world evangelism, that it actually takes a tribe? It actually takes us all working together to connect with our community. And it all takes different experiences. And isn't it so wonderful that God knows us so well, that each person is fearfully and wonderfully made, that we all bring something to a community like that? And quite often I know as leaders of a faith community, you're looking to us to do a lot of things. And while we have that responsibility, let me give you a heads up. If you're looking to us to do unbelievable, amazing things, we're all in trouble because we can only do what we can do. We need everyone engaged in this way. Evangelism really happens when we desire to use the gifts that God has given us to connect with people. And often they can just feel natural and we can even take them for granted. But I want to say to you today, look at that. Look at what God has gifted you with and how can you use that to connect with your community.
Is big.
Community to evangelize actually has to come from within. I just believe this 100%, that if we are shining for Jesus, no matter where we are, that people are kind of going to like what they see and they're going to want to check it out. That's the truth. So the Acts church, they gathered. They gathered at a time where they were required to give thanks for a harvest festival. They had come in, they were visiting, but they gathered. And the Holy Spirit came and just poured out on them. And they stayed and they connected with their community and they brought their gifts to God and showed it as a living sacrifice. And people thought, I like what I see there. I think I'm going to check that out. So what does that mean today as a faith community to us? Like, what can we get from this? Well, I think firstly, it's important that we gather. I'm going to just put that out there. I think it's really important that we gather, because when we gather, we encourage each other. We spur each other on. We are refueled in so many ways. And there's just something powerful about a faith community gathering and worshiping God together in one voice, in unison, through prayer and love, as we've explored over these last 2 weeks. There's nothing more powerful than that. So I think that's very important. So that would be my first start. I think the second part is that sometimes we're actually required to stay in the land God has given us and connect. It's actually just not enough for us to gather. It's not enough for us just to connect in with God and each other. God has actually given us a mission. If we want to be a fully fledged Jesus faith community, then we have to share Jesus with our community. That's just it. It's vital, it's foundational. So I think though that we're required to learn the language, and it might require us learning a new language. I'm telling you right now, Andrew and I are learning fast. We are learning so fast every week about how we can connect with you. I mean, we could have This is not who we are, but we could have said, do you know what? We just landed here 4 weeks ago. We don't know anyone in this church. We don't know anyone in this community. We don't even know who could do our editing. We don't know how we're going to do this. We could have just said, we're just going to sit Corona out and we'll regather at the end. Like, we could have done that, but we haven't. And I hope that you're seeing that we're desperately trying to connect with our community that God has given us and try and speak their language so that they can see the gospel maybe for the first time and understand it. I mean, I'm pretty sure, in fact, I'm almost 100% confident that our videos and our communication looks very different to just about any other church that is out there. We are not live streaming. We are not being something we're not. This is Andrew and I and our quirky sense of humor with all our imaginations, just trying to figure out how we can connect beyond the screen. Because here, I'm just preaching to a wall. But I'm hoping that you're hearing what I'm saying today and that I'm reaching you and trying to speak your language so that you can connect to the gospel. Not to me, but to the gospel, to the great creator, to the one who created us. And I really think that this virus has challenged us to readdress how we speak our word at the gospel out to the community. Like, we are learning, we are trying. If nothing else, they can say we're trying. But what I find is, when I read the scripture, I love what it said, is that the church was a place of joy, was a place of love, was a place of exuberant praise. So for Andrew and I, we believe that every podcast, every post, everything we do should express God's exuberant joy and we should praise him in every way possible. And so we hope that that's what you're hearing in this time. What does that mean post-COVID? I think it means we need a new language. We really need to know our community. We really need to know how to communicate to them. That's going to require us being disciplined. That's going to require us taking the time out to figure out how it looks. Because I don't know about you, but my world looks totally different. This is the strangest start to an appointment I have ever had in my entire life. I have just never gone somewhere and been somewhere 4 weeks and then said, sorry, you can't meet. That just can't happen. Like, the world has changed, right? Everything has changed. So we need to know how to speak this new post-COVID language. And that's just going to take discipline and time. The world is different. So I want to take this opportunity, to be honest. I want to take this opportunity is if you've kind of fallen over us or found us on the line somehow, if you've kind of just, oh, I'm looking at this crazy blonde today, what she's saying, I want to say to you, come give us a try. Like, come give us a try. Or if you've been before and you're like, oh, I don't know about church, I don't know about this, just give us a second chance. I'm asking you, give us a second chance because we want to learn the language to communicate to you God's love for you. I don't think we need to wait till after COVID. I don't think that's actually what God's asking us. Because Romans 12 says, take our ordinary, everyday lives, our sleeping, our eating, our going to work, walking around lives. So at no point does it say take a break while COVID's on and then come back. Just come back. I don't think he says that. No, he says, use what you've got now. Use what he's given you now. Take our ordinary everyday lives and use those gifts to bring people into the tribe of love that we are talking about. Because I don't have all the gifts. I don't have all the gifts. Andrew doesn't have all the gifts. But together we form a tribe of gifted people who are called to love the community. So I suppose if we want to knuckle evangelism right down to its very core, I suppose I think evangelism is obedience. It's just obedience. It's got nothing to do with shouting at people. It's got nothing to do with Bible bashing people. It's got nothing to do with tele-evangelists. It's got nothing to do with any of these. It's just got to do with obedience, because it's actually just that we want others to know about the love of God more than we want our own way. Okay, that's pretty powerful, don't you think? I was reminded of a song as I was preparing for this sermon, and as I'm in the Word, I mean, music speaks so much to me, and I know for many of you the same. And this song was sent as a gift to Andrew and I, and it just fitted with what I was speaking about, what God was revealing in me. And so thanks to our fabulous media team, honestly, please pray for them, because they work with Andrew and I, and you look, you just never know where we're going to go, and they are often reeling all the time. But thanks to them, we'll be able to share in this song. And if you know the artist Keith Green and his ministry, it just lives on. It's amazing. But this song, it just spoke to me. It's called "To Obey Is Better Than Sacrifice." And it just says these words: "To obey is better than sacrifice. I don't need your money. God doesn't need your money. I want your life." I mean, that's the key to evangelism. If God has your life, if he has it wholly and solely, your ordinary everyday life, if you're presenting that as a living sacrifice to him every day, then there'll be nothing more than people will be so attracted to you, because you will shine the love of Jesus in everything you do. To obey is better than sacrifice. I want more than Sundays and Wednesday nights. We can't just pretend to be church. We are the church. It's not a building. Because we're not meeting in a building doesn't mean the church isn't alive and well. It's alive and well. We are the church. Because I want you to come to me every day. Or don't bother coming at all. Evangelism comes from an inward place, when you love the Lord your God so much with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love others as yourself. That's evangelism. That's what it is. People will be attracted to that, because God's going to come back and he's going to hold us accountable for what we've done. And if we haven't done what he's asked us to do, if we haven't been obedient with the gifts he has given us, then we're going to have to stand before him and explain ourselves. And I really hope that I've done the right thing. Because to me, evangelism is when we gather and worship God. When we connect, stay and connect in our community and learn their language and bring our everyday, ordinary lives as an offering to God. And I think people are generally going to like what they see, and God will add to the number. But it has to come from within first. It has to come from within. So the challenge is, church. The challenge is, because you're the church, not the building, the church. The challenge is, church. Do people like what they see? Are you taking your everyday, ordinary life and presenting it as an offering to God, and it's shining out of you, and people look at you and go, I want whatever she's got. I want whatever he's got. I generally like what I'm seeing here. Then it won't be hard for God to add to our number, and you're on the right track, which is great. But if in your heart you know that maybe you're not being so obedient, that maybe you've got a little bit off track, that maybe you're not really oozing the Spirit of the Lord in everything that you do, I challenge you, as they sing this song, to just recommit your life back to Jesus. Connect in to him. In your lounge room, in your bedroom, if that's where you are, just take this moment right now to connect into him. Just take a breath and say, Lord, I want to see people in my community come into the kingdom of God. And I know it has to start with me. and I will do everything I can to make that happen. That is my challenge to you today. Look at your life, your everyday, ordinary life, and the community in which God has planted you, and ask the hard question. Are you moving people closer to Jesus? Are you moving people closer to his kingdom? Or are you just pretty happy in your comfort zone and don't want to step out? Because in the end, we're accountable to God. In the end, we have to hold that with him. So my prayer for you this week is that you will discover that. Let me pray with you before they sing this song. Holy Spirit, we thank you for Pentecost. We thank you because the Word of God came alive to every nation through Pentecost. We thank you that we can celebrate it even today, that we can be so impacted by it even today. And may we have a new Pentecost today in our homes, in our lives. May we spread the Word of God in everything that we do. I pray, Lord, that wherever people are gathering, whether it's online, on the phone, or in the mail, Lord, that they are gathering and being empowered by your word. And Lord, I pray that they're disciplining themselves so that they can speak a new language to a new season in this world, so that we can connect with the community that you have given us. And we will just do it in our everyday, ordinary lives. Lord, if there's things that we need to address in our ordinary, everyday life, would you bring it to forward? Would you show us? Would you open it? Would you open our hearts to that, Lord? So that we could absolutely shine with the love of Jesus, so that others would come to know you. That is our heart's cry as your church, as your bride, that when we stand before you, we will be held accountable. And you will say, well done, good and faithful servant. Holy Spirit, bless us on this day, we pray. Amen. Well, thank you for joining us. Thank you for switching in. And we pray you have a blessed day in every way. And we'll be back next week with Major Andrew's going to talk about training. We'll see what that happens. Bye.